Okay, hello, welcome everyone. This is a very exciting lecture. This is, we're coming from Durham College. This is our global classroom. Our lecture today is on eating disorders. Dr. Clark is our guest speaker, who I'll tell you more about in a minute, but I'd like to extend a really warm welcome to Nigeria, to University of Lauren. Can you hear me okay? I see that. We'd like to welcome you, and George Brown College as well. Welcome, welcome. George Brown, I went to George Brown College. I now teach at Durham College, but it's always nice to see Catherine again. She was my teacher. I know. So anyhow, I'd like to tell you a bit about, and we also remotely, you can't see them, we have our dental assisting class in a big classroom. Across the way here, and they're watching this live stream as we're doing this lecture. So there's a lot of exciting things happening. They'll be tweeting in with questions. You can feel free to ask. You can feel free to ask any questions as we go along with the lecture. But for now, I'd like to introduce you to Dr. David Clark. Some of you know him already, but I'll give you a few of his credentials here. He doesn't let me talk very much about himself, although there's a lot to say. Dr. Clark has been clinical director for
Sorry, can you just ask Nigeria to mute?
Nigeria, can you mute your
microphone? Yeah, just turn off your microphone for now.
Just for a second. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay.
Okay,
that's great. Yeah. Okay. So Dr. Clark has been clinical director for Ontario Shores Center for Mental Health Services in the dental clinic for almost 30 years. He's also a clinical associate clinic, works as an associate in clinical dentistry at the University of Toronto, Faculty of Dentistry. Dr. Clark has his master's in oral pathology. He's written a number of publications on mental health and dentistry and oral pathology. We have the great fortune of having him work with us in our dental clinics here at Durham College and also at George Brown College. And it's just always a wonderful experience to work with Dr. Clark and to be part of his lectures because we all learn so much from him. So it's with great pleasure that I introduce you to Dr. David Clark. Thank you.
Thanks, Astrid. Good morning, everybody. Those here and I think in the room next door, downtown Toronto, George Brown, and as far away as Nigeria. It's great to have everybody here tuning in. For the group, that's... Is that me?
No, Nigeria. It might get a little bumpy at times, but keep going.
Okay. For the group that's here, you recall I gave you a lecture about 2 weeks ago talking about special care patients and mental health issues, and we kind of reserved the part about eating disorders until this particular lecture. So that's where we're going to sort of pick up where we left off. I'm looking at a different screen there. Just as a real simple statement, if you will, and this could apply to a lot of your patients. One's oral health can really mirror what is going on in that patient's life at any particular time. And when we talk about mental health issues, your oral health can reflect the ups and downs that one is going through dealing with a lot of these, as we talked last 2 weeks ago, serious health issues. And so we talked about depression, and we talked a little bit about psychotic behavior, schizophrenia, but we also can reference this to eating disorders as well. And I hope that, if nothing else, there's a lot of information which I'm probably not going to end up finishing, but at the end of the time this morning, I'm hoping that one or two, or maybe if I'm lucky, three people will leave wherever they are, having a little bit better understanding, appreciation, and empathy for the seriousness that eating disorders represents. And I hope that I can shed some light on that as we go through. Eating disorders, some of the possible and often likely complications of long-term eating disorders problems, and we'll get specifics in a minute, is ultimately impairment of oral function, increasing pain, loss of aesthetics, effect on one's quality of life. This is just the oral or dental aspects. But of course, as we know, there's many more serious consequences of eating disorders. The thing is that often these oral or dental findings are occurring in a relatively early part of one's life. And so it very quickly can overtake the patient's feelings, self-esteem, and so forth, and compound what they are already dealing with in terms of issues of self-esteem and body image and body weight. So a lot of the information that I'm talking about really comes from what I've learned and asking questions and so forth from the eating disorders unit that opened recently, now 2.5 years ago, at the hospital that I've been associated with. This is a 12-bed eating disorders unit that we have at our hospital. So it is different than many of the other programs that have existed elsewhere in the province, whereas the kids that come in here, they stay here. They don't come in for the day and go home at night and come back in the morning, which is the basis of a lot of programs. They come here and they stay and they receive whatever treatment is able to be provided to them. So we really need 1,200 beds devoted to this illness. Not 12, but it's better than nothing. And because of this, families that went into great expense to take their child into the States, for example, to programs there or across the country, wherever, can now come locally. And so this covers a wide area of our province, not just Whitby. It's Ottawa and east and west and north and stuff. So with eating disorders, what we see in this 12-bed unit is really the tip of the iceberg of what is out there in terms of the severity of this illness and the epidemic nature that exists. And eating disorders are prevalent. They are often underdiagnosed, late diagnosed, but they are extremely prevalent. Frequently misunderstood, source of great stigma on the part of the individual who's dealing with this issue, and associated with a significant medical comorbidity and risk of end of life through suicide. So I showed the group here last week, 2 weeks ago, how a diagnosis is made for any of the serious mental health issues. And so it doesn't involve a stethoscope, you know, as we would with a cardiac issue. It doesn't involve taking blood work. Imaging studies do not render a diagnosis. The diagnosis, as you know, will come out of this manual in North America. Europe uses a different diagnostic manual, but again, based on the approach, the descriptive approach to a cluster of symptoms that the patient is exhibiting at one point in time. And so we went through the axes of psychosocial health, and of course, in the first axis of clinical disorders, we have eating disorders present, as well as many other diagnoses we talked about. So how do we define eating disorders? Well, there's a lot of definitions, but really, if you really want to boil it down, it's the judging one's self-esteem and how one appears to others based on their weight, based on your body shape. And that's how people dealing with these, who have developed these disorders, are approaching life, the judgment based on how they look. But if you want to get a little more technical, eating disorders in general are really a group of psychological and pathological disorders, psychopathological, affecting a patient's relationship or an individual's relationship with food and their body. And it manifests outwardly as disturbance in their eating behavior, chaotic eating behavior. And so it often represents a characterization of food-related problems as a means to express internal struggling, stresses, conflicts, whatever you want to call it. It's often looked upon as a coping strategy, a poor coping strategy. And dieting becomes often quickly a means to measure one's self-esteem. You're all going to see patients. How many in this room know someone who is dealing or struggling with an eating disorder? Okay, so I'd probably add a few more hands because I know there's some that are reluctant to raise their hands. Statistically, there would be more hands. If you look at this is Well, this is one research paper's interpretation of sort of the progression, how these illnesses develop. Dieting, a lot of people diet, and nothing really happens. They diet, maybe they're successful, maybe not, and they give it up, and that's it. But it's when, again, it crosses that line, it becomes an impairment, it starts to take over the individual. And so in childhood, this group looked at different traits that may be present within the child or within the family unit. Negative emotions, strive for perfectionism, strive and perfectionism in terms of body shape, being thin, don't gain weight. You need this to be competitive, to succeed in activities in school and outside school. Someone with a bit more obsessive compulsive personality. So genetics does play a role here. Okay, and then once we reach adolescence, the whole floodgates are open with hormones. Everything starts to go upside down, and we have more stress. We have certainly cultural influences, your peer groups, and things like, and people like that that really capitalize on the traits that may be present in one person versus another. And this just progresses into adulthood, with dieting, of course, being the central theme and resulting in often, you know, just the cyclical pathology as the individual moves forward. The risk factors in general for developing an eating disorder are considered to be female, adolescent, early puberty, early onset of puberty, early onset of that hormonal rush, and being on a diet. And the only factor that can be changed in this list is to not diet. Everything else you can't change. The risk factors for an individual, for specific risk factors, so this is another way of looking at that chart I showed you, was a family history. Family history of depression, family history of eating disorders, family history of alcoholism or substance abuse, depression, and family history of obesity. Premorbid, sort of early on in the pre-adolescent period, adverse parenting, low contact, poor communication, expectations by parents on kids to perform, to be competitive, to win, family dysfunction, family discord, history of abuse, a big predictor in some cases of future problems. It could be any kind of abuse, but sexual abuse is often the main one. Family dieting, focus on dieting. Comments about eating, not just from parents, but also from peers and so forth. The bad foods versus the good foods. Risk premorbid characteristics of an individual who may become more prone to developing any one of these eating disorders is low self-esteem initially. Perfectionism, more of a characteristic for anorexia versus bulimia. Anxiety disorders, obesity again, early onset of puberty for females. So, I showed this last time, the combination of what causes severe mental illness, and it's this model. Biological, psychological, social, cultural, all these influences. And we can't forget genetics as well. Genetics does play a role in development of eating disorders. So, some statistics that are pretty significant is in this country, in any given year, up to 990,000 Canadians will be suffering from an eating disorder. And there's new cases diagnosed every year. In Ontario, according to Health Canada, one in two girls, and I've talked about female as that one of those predictors, but it does occur in males as well, and increasingly so in males. And one in five boys in grade 10 were either on a diet or wanted to lose weight. There are reports that children in grade 1 are talking about dieting. It's a topic of their conversation, grade 1. Anorexia, typical age of onset is between 14 and 18 years of age, a little bit later on for bulimia. And it's becoming more common with each generation of children. second most common chronic illness in adolescent girls, and it has the highest mortality rate of any psychiatric illness or severe mental illness in this age group, 12 times the normal rate. 1 in 10 will die from their eating disorder through suicide, usually. 1 in 10 will die from the eating disorder, 1 in 5 will die from suicide as the end of life event. And in some cases, depending on the delay in diagnosis, the severity, the refractory nature of the treatment, it can shorten one's lifespan by up to 20 years. Leading causes of death in eating disorders are starvation, suicide, and sudden cardiac death. Those that will survive, and there are survivors, there are individuals who respond well to the treatments, to the programs, and they are successful, and they move on back into their lives again and carry on very well. Half, though, will develop these medical consequences or psychological sort of side effects, if you will, of the disease that will last and that will persist for the rest of their life. Many patients will require rehospitalization over time. And the risk for developing comorbid mental health issues, such as mood disorders, anxiety disorders, obsessive compulsive, are much higher in this group of individuals. Majority do not access treatment, certainly not in a timely fashion. It's a disease of secrecy. The delay in treatment speaks to the greater risk of the complications, and it will affect development because we're talking about young individuals. The kids that are in this 12-bed unit, nobody's over the age of 18. I think now we've had our first boy admitted. I'm not sure if he's 10 years old, but he's quite young. And the misperception in the old literature that eating disorders only happen to white middle class individuals is no longer. It happens across the spectrum. It was interesting, we had a grand rounds last week, very timely, by our eating disorders unit. And in fact, three girls blew me away. I had no idea at the beginning. I honestly didn't know. Three girls got up. I could have just picked you. Three got all dressed up. Got up at the front of a packed room this time to talk about eating disorders. And I thought they were social workers. Had me fooled. I guess I need my glasses changed or something. But as the conversation went through, they started talking in the first person. And eventually I realized that they were still in the unit in treatment, but wanted to put this together to tell everybody what it was like, what they're going through. And then they had the psychiatrist, who's an eating disorder specialist, sort of talk with them and back them up with some facts and things like that. And interestingly, and I'm getting off topic here, but I did not know, and I probably should know with some grandkids in public school, that lunches are monitored now. When you go to school, you have people, parents, I guess, who actually go through every kid's lunch and pull out the bad foods. I had no idea. It blew me away. And she said that actually this is contributing to eating disorders problems. You know, you've got a little kid who comes into the class and an adult comes up and says, sorry, that cupcake's no good. You know, those cookies, you're not having those cookies. Take them away. So you've undermined the authority of the child's parent. That's the first thing. So what's the child thinking? Mommy and daddy said I could take this. It was okay once in a while, but the lunch police have confiscated them, right? Which is what they are. And the second thing is, you've got that child growing up confused that what's good? Like, what's a good food? What's a bad food? Like, the child is confused. And so we're actually creating more of a problem in terms of eating disorders than we think we are. And so it's a really interesting statistic. Yeah, it is scary. It is. Because all of you, you're going to be faced with that someday, and you're going to have to deal with that. And you're, you know, confront those in charge. So anorexia, What is it exactly? It's really a disease, an eating disorder based on restriction of food, restriction of intake. You can have a binge purging type as well, but for a large part, it's restriction. And so if you go to that book, and then these are the criteria that come together to perhaps create a diagnosis for an individual, refusing to maintain body weight at or near a normal weight, 15-20%, distortion of body image. Anorexia, patients with anorexia are actually, they're actually feel pretty good about what they're doing because they're achieving what they set out to do. Once they start restricting, they're successful. They think it's a success to them. Very hard to treat anorexia. They think it's, they're happy with what's going on. It's not right, doesn't mean it's right, obviously. And for women who are affected most of the time, once that the monthly cycle has been missed at least three or more times, that's one of the sort of criteria that are in this book. So, with anorexia, there's a refusal to eat certain foods. There's no carbs. There's the good foods, and then there's the bad foods. There's rituals around foods. There's playing with it on the plate. All sorts of things. But they can prepare, serve, and do whatever with food. They just, there's no intake involved. It's a restriction. And one of the focus of the eating disorders unit is getting these kids who have not been eating and have this poor relationship with food to get them to eat again, slowly but surely. Eventually, with starvation, I don't have to tell you, you know, what starvation would lead to, but everything shuts down eventually. Every organ system will shut down. And ultimately, if it goes on long enough without proper treatment and care, cardiac events are usually the end of life for individuals. On the other hand, bulimia, which is really just considered by some is anorexia, a failed anorexic, if I will. So you start out the same way, but you end up getting interrupted by these periods of binge eating. And there's so much guilt and so much anguish over this that an individual will start to revert to things to eliminate what they need, a purging behavior. So, sort of the same idea in the beginning, but interrupted by these episodes of binge eating. So this is the definition that the book has for this group. A higher percentage of patients with anorexia, with bulimia, suffer from other personality disorders, anxiety disorders, and substance abuse is a big factor as well.
Camera's jammed. Keep going. Okay. Hand it back. Sorry about that. I'm in there in the back.
So who's on the...
Oh,
it's you.
Get it back and won't
okay.
Move. Okay, anyways.
I'll distract them for you.
I might have to manually read it, but there we go.
So this is the sort of the cycle with bulimia. The binge eating, the guilt that's experienced by an individual, the need to purge, to remove, eliminate, and it just becomes a very vicious cycle. And that is why, because of the combination of the binge eating and the purging, an individual with bulimia may not often look as emaciated as someone who suffers from anorexia alone, who's restricted. Often a patient, an individual may look at normal weight, or maybe a little bit overweight. Complications from bulimia can involve the mode of purging, what is the mechanism, whether it's chemicals that are taken in to stimulate vomiting, or the mechanical means, rupturing of the esophagus, tears of the esophagus, aspiration pneumonias, and so forth. Also, the effects of substance abuse, I'm going to throw that in everywhere, and suicide. Again, becomes an end-of-life event. Nowhere else to turn. This is what happens. So, medically, anorexia is often the complications result of the starving and restriction, bulimia, the mode of purging. And both are susceptible to other comorbid mental health issues that we see. And, interestingly, as a result of this grand rounds I attended last week, the psychiatrist gets up in front of everybody and says, There is no good medical treatment as of today for anorexia. There is no good evidence-based treatment. They just don't have it. With bulimia, they do. Cognitive behavioral therapy is very effective, and antidepressants are actually very effective with bulimia. In some cases, they consider to have an anti-bulimic effect, reducing the frequency of purging. So with bulimia, there's good treatments available. With anorexia, sadly, today, still, there is nothing good out there that can be used. And she basically said, the program at Ontario Shores, they just listen to the kids. The kids will tell them what is bothering them, what is the problem, what they want. She said that was the most important thing, is to listen to the kids. The most important thing for you is, and I tell the dental students as well, is to listen to the patient. The patient will tell you what you, information for a diagnosis and everything. And we don't listen enough, in my opinion, but this is what they have to do. There's a disturbed eating behavior. It's not an eating disorder as is recorded in this manual. But patients with diabetes type 1 will learn to administer less insulin in order to promote weight loss. It's called diabulimia. So it is a disturbed eating behavior. It's not a sort of a clinical disorder yet. But it is, and there are other eating behaviors too. There's other disturbed eating behaviors. There's a one called orthorexia nervosa. So you got anorexia, you've got orthorexia, which is just the opposite. It's actually an obsession with healthy eating to an extreme. It just becomes extreme in nature. Anything in extreme is not good. And so that's another type of disturbed eating behavior. So what I'm going to read to you, having gone through some of those characteristics and things like that, I think this sums it up really well. I'm going to read to you one of the first admission assessments for a patient who came to the eating disorders unit back in 2014. And we saw her in the clinic. We've seen many of them already. And this hopefully will sum up what those characteristics, what the background is that led to this patient coming into this hospital. And once they get admitted to Ontario Shores, they will have had to exhaust all other programs in the area, in the city, to qualify to get into this program. This is the last resort in some cases for them. This is their last chance. Ms. X is a 17-year-old girl who lives with her mother. So this is back 2014. She has an 18-year-old sister away at college and a 32-year-old half-sister living with her father. The parents together for 21 years, then separated 5 years before. She worries about her mother. She has been admitted to hospital 15 times in the last 2 years with stays ranging from 3 days to 2 months. So put yourself back in the mind of a 17 when you were 17 and that kind of thing. Ms. X first developed symptoms when she was in grade 5 at age 10. She was struggling with unhappiness and stressed by her family situation. Her parents' marriage ended and her father left. Her mother was drinking and she felt she had to take care of her mother. She decided not to eat breakfast one day and forgot her lunch. She felt different and liked it. She soon discovered that focusing on schoolwork and on her eating and her weight became a distraction from her real emotional issues, and they became habit. So the line's been crossed. She was also running on the cross-country team because she thought it would help how her body looked. Again, another feature, particularly with anorexia, that pursuit of those programs, exercise regimens, activities, all with the thought that it's going to continue to cause weight loss, burn those calories. She had always been small and liked the attention of being tiny. She also spent a summer visiting an aunt who was very focused on healthy eating and losing weight. This reinforced her behaviors. She managed to evade discovery until about 2 years ago, 2012, I guess, when her parents noticed dramatic weight loss and restriction. Then she had those 15 admissions all around the province, plus day treatments and family therapies with her mother. She began purging last year, the year before admission, and at its worst, she vomited at every intake. Every time she ate, She purged. She had just been discharged from a six-week admission, so was only purged a couple of times in recent weeks. She gained 12 pounds while in hospital. She has also used laxatives, and this has also started in the last year. She has used them up for 4 days in a row, but not used any recently. She struggles with impulsive exercising, where she feels compelled at times to exercise and then will have to get up and move. She's 4'11". Her weight is 88 pounds. Highest weight was 120. Lowest was 70 pounds. She's made suicide attempts from the age of 10. She didn't want to go into the details at this time. First time she tried to suffocate herself. Then she tried strangulation with something wrapped around her neck, cutting herself, drowning. she's just too young to know how to do it, basically, is what they're saying. They failed because she didn't know what she was doing. More recently, she's tried overdoses twice with a whole bottle of Tylenol and went to bed. She reports being diagnosed with depression, anxiety. She reports being quite sad, at times hopeless. She's tired of having an eating disorder and wants to recover. She also worries about her mother. She has self-harm in the past, cutting her wrists and thighs. She's only cut twice in hospital this time. She's had two episodes where she cut daily for 1 to 2 months. She finds it helps her feel better because she feels something and it feels like she's doing something. That's probably the basis why people will cut themselves. So if you read into that, and like, you know, there's many more, they all have those same kinds of features in them, the struggles that an individual is experiencing. Okay. We may be the first ones in the health professions to identify someone who we may think has an eating disorder or who's dealing with an eating disorder. That's the whole purpose of why I'm up here talking to you. One of the reasons. you can actually get all this in a good textbook, or I can give you this handout, but it's actually the reality is what I'm trying to get across to you. It is real. I can't stress it enough, it's real. We may see the changes to the teeth and amongst other things, which I'll go through, and we may be in a position to initiate some kind of thinking on the part of the child, or maybe engage in some discussion with the child and or the parent, if we are concerned. So the changes that we see are a result of nutritional disturbances, the altered intake, restrictions, lack of good hygiene. Remember, you've got somebody who's struggling with this disease, who's also probably depressed, maybe abusing substances. The last thing they're going to be doing is picking up a toothbrush and doing the modified whatever technique to clean all the plaque off you're learning in school. And that's great, but that's not going to be real. And the comorbidity side effects of medications. We talked about antidepressants and the physical changes that we may see. So if we go through a little bit very briefly of the sort of the pathology that we can see lesions on the mucosa as a result of vitamin deficiencies, as a result of trauma, to modes of purging, depending what's used. So iron deficiencies, again, you can look it up in the textbook, the changes that you get on the tongue, particularly with iron deficiency and with vitamin B12, the very characteristic appearances that you'll get. This is the psychiatrist that back in the 1970s, British psychiatrist, who actually coined the term bulimia, who actually developed the diagnosis and description of bulimia. And he described, and he gave his name to the often calluses and bruises that are seen on the hand of someone who repeatedly uses that hand to put it in their mouths, initiate purging. You know, you're hitting the teeth, you're damaging the skin repeatedly. You know, if you do it every day, 3-4 times a day. So this is called Russell's sign. And you can actually see the indents of the incisors there in some cases. Another patient, just a case report, who used something to initiate purging, some kind of trauma, maybe a utensil. This is a fancy term for loss of blood supply to a part of the palate. And I just put it on because it was an unusual presentation in bulimia, but it causes necrosis of the tissue by cutting off the blood supply, ischemia, and this gets all, looks like that, it looks like cancer. First thing, hopefully you all come out of the school and you think that would be cancer. Your teachers will be proud of you, but it wasn't cancer, and it's just a result of the trauma to that area of the salivary gland tissue in the palate. The sad thing is these have been misdiagnosed as squamous cell carcinoma by inexperienced pathologists, and people have had resections of their maxilla. This will clear up in 10 weeks. But they've had their mouths rearranged, if you will, irreversibly. Nutritional deficiencies as a result of vitamin C, the lack of repair to the collagen, to the gum tissues, periodontal tissues. And then we've got where we want to be with pH in the mouth. We want to be at a neutral pH in the mouth, and gastric acid is just one level up from battery acid. It's that caustic. So you've got that constant reflux, constant coming up of this gastric acids, causing this erosion that can occur after a period of time. And so we get this appearance that we see here, particularly on the lingual surfaces of the maxillary teeth, where it looks like it's been kind of shiny. It's very shiny and sort of polished and worn away gradually. So that's one thing you might see when you look into somebody's mouth, especially a younger person. If it's somebody who's been dealing with this for some time and has pre-existing amalgam fillings in it, those fillings are going to start to risk to appear to lift out of the tooth. It's the tooth that's actually reducing. The amalgam is still where it was, but it gives that impression. So eventually, if you wear away the central incisors long enough, you'll thin them out. What's going to happen? They're going to start to chip and fracture. And then you get into aesthetic concerns. And that's one of the issues that I talked about at the very beginning, the aesthetic issues and so forth, which can affect one's quality of life further than it already is. Patients who are pursuing all these exercise regimens or any kind of vigorous activity will often use energy drinks, which by themselves are very acidic, very detrimental to the enamel. And they also satisfy the hunger stimulus. So drinking a lot of these energy drinks that are on the market will actually suppress that hunger stimulus and contribute further to the restriction that the individual's engaged in. Sensitivity. As we wear down the teeth, you know, a 15-year-old kid's going to come in and say, my teeth are sensitive. Or the parent's going to come in and say, why are they sensitive? Please check for cavities. Well, there's nothing there. They've had fluoride for years. They've grown up with this perfect dentition. Why are the teeth sensitive? And this is could be a reason why, because of the loss of the enamel. So, again, something to keep in mind. The risk of caries increases, particularly with those engaged in the binge-eating behaviors and the lack of good hygiene. So you've got a lot of carbohydrates coming in, and we all know what that does without proper hygiene. Another interesting finding is the what's called nutritional mumps, if you will, bilateral swelling of the parotid glands. Sometimes before the intraoral features occur, this is one of the sort of the extraoral findings, where the salivary glands actually enlarge over time. So it's referred to in some literature as nutritional mumps as opposed to the old-fashioned type of mumps. Some of the other changes, I've seen one or two, I think one for sure, young girl who came in to see us, but at the same time was undergoing testing for osteoporosis, osteopenia, loss of bone mass, which is going to be another longer-term consequence of these diseases. So just a summary of that. But, so the influence of depression, and we talked about this last week to the group, somebody who is majorly depressed is not going to engage in any of the oral hygiene behaviors that you so proudly talk about and enforce with your patients. They could care less. They just won't brush their teeth, and you're going to end up with the problems that go along with that. And you may combine that with the side effects of medication. And I just saw a couple of patients yesterday in the clinic. You sit down and you can spot a dry mouth, or you will be able to very quickly just by listening to the patient talk. And sure enough, you know, this patient's on multiple medications which create a very dry mouth. So the antidepressants that are on the market may be of more benefit for patients who are being treated for bulimia. The comorbidity of substance abuse plays a big role as well, and that just compounds the ability of the patient to get treatment or respond to treatment or cooperate and be compliant with treatment. Again, that's a coping strategy. They're reaching for something as opposed to talking for about something. How can we help? If we know somebody is engaged in this behavior but hasn't so-called come out about it to anybody, but we may have a little bit of insight into this is going on, we can tell them. We can help them. Here's what you can do to minimize the damage that this is causing your teeth. And so there are ways to enhance salivary flow, using water, of course. We all know what dry mouth results in. I'm just going to skip over this part because you'll get this in other lectures. But neutralizing the acids in the mouth, refraining from brushing the teeth for at least an hour after any episode of purging. At least an hour. Rinsing the mouth, perhaps. Some people say bicarbonate soda. Some people say that's not really effective because it dissolves very quickly. You know, you might have patients who come in and say, I brushed with baking soda. And in fact, baking soda is probably very ineffective because once it mixes with water, it just dissolves. It's whereas at least with toothpaste, it hangs around for a little while. Prescribing fluoride, high concentration fluoride toothpaste, fluoride varnishes, fluoride rinses, whatever you want to offer the patient. So there's just some different ways. This came out a couple of years ago now. It was a survey done in the States of an eating disorders clinic. And the average age of the people who completed this, about over a third completed, or two-thirds completed the survey, was 27 years of age. And what they want to know is, what do you do after purging in terms of your oral care? Because it was American Dental Association thing. And so they looked at the findings, and over 93% of the people that completed the survey had a dental problem, admitted to it, some kind of dental problem, one or more. 70% had sensitive teeth. Well, we can see where that comes from. Another good percentage had erosion, clinical evidence of erosion of the enamel, which in half the cases resulted in changes to the color of the teeth, the shape of the teeth. When you've got erosion, you get that very dull kind of luster look to the teeth as opposed to the shiny enamel that you see. You can spot it pretty quickly. Tooth pain, oral lesions, which may be related to the mode of purging, whatever they're sticking in their mouths to initiate vomiting, decay, and dry mouth. What's that? Oh, okay. So they asked them, you know, when do you brush, or do you brush right after? And almost a third said, yeah, they brush right after purging behavior. Interestingly, 30% of the ones that completed this said that you guys or me or any oral health professional was helpful in giving them information on what to do. But most of them turned to the internet, which is probably, you know, not a great thing to do. I had a young girl in last year who was purging, and we talked about it after her teeth were fine. We talked about it. I sat her up in the chair, and I started to, you know, do you know what to do? She said, oh, it's just no problem. I Googled it. I know everything, you know, and she recited everything that she has to do. So I said, well, that's a good hit, I guess, in that case. You got the right information. But most people turn to the internet. And so they asked them, what can we do? What could we do to help you manage this problem as you're going through it, whether you're going through treatment or before treatment or whatever, before a diagnosis, but you are purging. They suggested including information on websites. So I always get the dentists in the group, I always have fun sort of, you know, putting in my two cents with them. I say, well, you know, you could put this on your website next to what you do in terms of veneers, whitening, all the things that you claim you do. How about some down-to-earth stuff for patients? Eating disorders would be one thing. Human papillomavirus would be another thing, with oral pharyngeal carcinoma. If we really want to embrace the concept of being oral physicians, or whatever you want to call us, we really have to get a little bit out of the aesthetics field. And otherwise, it's going to be taken away from us completely. Display material in the waiting room. Having some pamphlets there that people will pick up
and tuck into their pocket or purse when nobody else is looking, because they know somebody in their family or their friend's daughter who is dealing with this. And all of a sudden they walk into your office and they see something on the wall that's talking about eating disorders, you know, not Invisalign and not CEREP machines and things like that. They will pick it up. And that makes us look really good. And that's, you know, that's we need to embrace this. The other thing was reducing, engaging in conversation more, not being afraid to talk about this. And as I said at the outset, the secrecy is extremely powerful in this group of diseases, eating disorders. Secrecy is really what's holding everybody back. Reducing negative emotions. There is no place for judgment with any of these illnesses. No place at all. Definitive restorative treatment, of course, is delayed until purging behavior is ceased and one can go on safely to restore the damage that's been done for these individuals. So treatment planning has to be flexible, dynamic, aggressive on prevention, be realistic. But this is the most important thing. Having comfort and empathy talking about this. And as I said at the time, 2 weeks ago, I said, I wasn't just talking about the patients that come into this clinic or will come into your office with depression, with eating disorders, with schizophrenia. I'm talking about the families that are dealing with this as well, who are bringing this patient in, or this patient's coming from a family where somebody is struggling with this disease. We have to be able to discuss it in a very non-judgmental, empathetic fashion. And whether you like it or not, it's going to happen. You're going to encounter this probably several times in your career. We need to fight the stigmatizing attitudes towards eating disorders. The actual public attitudes are pretty dismal. They're more stigmatizing actually towards eating disorders than they are to depression or schizophrenia, if you can believe that. This is what the literature is showing. And eating disorders are one of the most highly marginalized diseases in mental health programs. And the hospital system we have actually contributes to the chronic nature of eating disorders. Because somebody who's admitted to a general hospital up at Lakeridge or something in a crisis for eating disorders, for example, they will get stabilized from a medical point of view and then turfed out as quickly as possible. The key to cure is not the medical stabilization, but it's also looking at what is causing it, the psychological problems. That's the success. That's what this program is doing at Ontario Shores. And there may be others like it, I don't know. That's the key. But right now, in medicine, there is very little, there's next to $0 in research, but there's very little in the terms of the whole picture for the individual. They just want to fix them up and get them out. They get their weight up, they're gone. But there's no support, there's no education, there's no discussion with that individual. Public feels that you're responsible for your eating disorder. Is this your problem? You brought it on, you deal with it. It's your fault. You know, you shouldn't have dieted. You know, look what happened to you. You know, I told you. And so it just goes downhill from there. You can pull yourself out of it, though. Yeah, just stop eating the carbs, you know. Last point that the psychiatrist made, and I thought it was pretty cool as well, is we are so focused on numbers in terms of what we eat. We are so focused on calories. How much? This much. Bad food, good food. That eating has become such a chore. Whereas in her day, and she's younger than me, so but I don't know if you ever, in high school, I don't think you wouldn't take this in high school anymore. It's home economics. Mm-hmm. You do?
I took it.
You learned to cook?
Yeah, I learned how to cook.
Okay. But the whole basis of learning to cook was to be social. Everybody gets together, you have fun, you make a meal. The family unit, that used to be the way it was. You'd enjoy getting together for a meal. You that was the important part of it. Now, there's no such thing. And it's become, you know, counting the numbers, calories and so forth, has become the obsession. And we're passing it on to our kids as well. And sadly, the other thing I didn't know this in the schools as well, that most of the schools have done away with lunch hour. There's actually no lunch hour. You have an hour. Technically, in some school boards, you can eat from 9 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the afternoon when you go home, before you go home. But they do give them breaks, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, like a coffee break, maybe a half hour. And you have to gobble down what's left of the lunch that wasn't stolen by the police. And that's your lunch hour. So, but there's no social, there's very little social interaction with the meal. It's just, you know, get it, eat it, and get out, you know, run around the yard for 10 minutes or something. So it's a whole different focus in our relationship with food and things like that. So it's very real. Some people feel that anybody with a mental health issue is using that to gain attention. So I'm going to start purging 3 times a day just so you guys will, you know, you'll pay attention to me. And there's greater discomfort. People don't want to talk to somebody who's dealing with these issues. They're afraid. Are they afraid they're going to catch it? They're afraid that somebody's going to haul off and hit them and all those myths. And that's what's really isolating, preventing this moving forward as much as we need to move forward. So, wherever you can, talk about it. Don't be shy with your patients. If they want to talk about it, they will. If they don't, they won't. But if you show an interest, and you show an interest in how you can help them with their dry mouth or with the erosion, they may pick up on that and say, hey, this is the first time somebody's really kind of moved that ahead a little bit. And just, I'm thinking maybe they know something about it. Maybe I can talk about them, you know, with them. So, there's some, I think you got, you can have this.
PowerPoint.
And there's these are Canadian references, I think, which give you a little bit more information if you're interested. So, any questions? That's it in a very fast nutshell. But, don't clap for me. Clap for the kids down there. And in the community, you're gonna see it. It's extremely important. Epidemic. It is an epidemic. We're just not looking for it. We're not paying attention to it. But you're gonna see it in your patients. You're gonna see it in the offices. So please keep your eyes open.
So how did you enjoy that lecture with Dr. Clark?
The lecture is okay.
Yeah. Is it what courses are you taking at your university?
What did you say?
What program are you in? What are you taking at your university? Are you in science? Are you in
management?
Management. Oh, okay. So it's kind of something different for you then, right?
Okay.
Yeah. So, is it something that you can relate to in your? Can you relate to this in your culture? At all?
Yeah, of course.
That's interesting for our students to know because we're in dental, and it's something we look for with our clients. So it's nice to know internationally how, as Dr. Clark said, it's an epidemic for us here. And more obvious in North America, but we world statistics do we have? Not really, right?
Or...
About the topic.
Well,
maybe concerning the topic of the it is not related to our topic, but we gained something from the lecture.
Oh, wonderful. So, so what did you gain from the lecture? What was your the most interesting thing? And tell Dr. Clark I shouldn't be in here.
Go ahead.
Okay.
There we go.
Like if... Yes. Okay, this topic actually talks to us about cleanliness of the mouth, actually, of the teeth too. Like, it talks about the way that we should be able to fight the stigma if you see someone with such. We should be able to communicate with the person, not run away from the person, thinking it's a disease that we will contact or something.
Yes, very, very good. Thank you for sharing that. Absolutely, that is definitely the biggest problem we have. It's the communication piece, and we so thank you for joining us. It's really been a pleasure to have you as our guests here in our global lecture. Thank you so much. It's wonderful.
It's a pleasure.
Any questions? Yeah. Any questions from the class here? Do you have any questions for these ladies, Nicole?
Is it only some people don't take alcohol, but they still have these mouth disease? Is it only people that take alcohol that can have this kind of issue?
Alcohol. If alcohol causes mouth.
Yes, alcoholism or long-term alcoholism can cause the erosion to the teeth as well. Yes. Over time. Yep. I just put that on as an example, another example of erosion, but yeah.
I got it.